been studying on the series on the word of honor, and today we are concluding on that series. Amen. On the word of honor. So take your notebooks. If you are online, be active. You can be called to read the Bible right now. So be active. Don't join online and be sleeping or be doing something else. Be active. Take your Bibles and take your notebooks as we continue our series on the word of honor. Amen. I want to officially welcome all of us to our Sunday service, which we are holding for temporarily online. Amen. Yeah, temporarily. So if you're a leader, please and call. Whether some of the leadership pages or some of the pages are not active. I also preach and music very active, especially during Sundays. You see Sister Frida sending messages there, and telling them that we are online, do well to join. These are the link, and you see outreach doing the same. But the others, the ushers, the ushering department, and other departments, I never see you do that. But there's some people too who are part of your department who are never joining. So put messages there and call them. Call them. Amen. Amen. I want to say you are all welcome. And I want you all to take your books, your Bibles. And this month has been month of studies. Amen. How many of you believe that it has been month of studies? We've been studying on the word of honor, the word of God. The first time we talked about, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. And he says, shall not return. And the audios are available, please. So in case you want to get the audios, we've been recording them so you can get them and listen to them again. Amen. It's important to love to study. We talked about, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth, shall not return unto me void, but I shall accomplish that which I send it to do. And we explained a lot of things concerning the release of the word of God. Amen. We shared briefly on the release of the word of God and how the word of God is likened to a rain and how the word of God is likened to, that was the first Sunday when we started talking about the word of honor or the rain of the word. And I went on the next week to really explain on why our teachers are very important, why we need teachers. Amen. And why you hear the word of God in the book of Isaiah, when it says you shall hear the word of God, if you miss your way, saying this is the way, walk ye in it. Amen. Is that not powerful? Yeah, and we talk about the bread of sorrows and afflictions and how important it is for us to take the word of God very serious, because it gives us directions and all that. Very powerful teachings. And last week we talked about Job and some of the things. He says, I've esteemed the word of his mouth more than my necessary food. So all our emphasis throughout this month has been an emphasis on the word of God, because the word is the month has been declared by the Holy Ghost as the month of spiritual enlightenment. And it's very important that we understand these things. Come on, shout glory. And it's important that we follow these teachings. There is, oh, shout glory, are you there? Yeah. So very important. Very important. Shout glory. Okay. Hallelujah. To me, Yeho, Yanko, Pondia, to me, Yeho, Dea, oh, to me, Yeho. manya. Oh, bon. Oh, do me. Da bakasa. Oh, dea. To me, yeah, whoa, day. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Shout glory. Say the word of God. Is God speaking to me? Say the word of God. Is God speaking to me? Hallelujah. Okay, so we are finalizing our series on the word of honor. I want us to open Job, where we've decided to explain all this well, and we've not been able to. Job chapter 22. Verse 20. Kati Asifa Lakadosh. Job chapter 22. Siba Deke Seta. Verse 21. And someone should read it for us. Amen. Please, who is reading? So we are talking about the word of honor. Amen. That's part 4, right? It's part 4. Today I want to really centralize on the power of studies. The power of study. So you can write it down. The word of honor. Then under the word of honor, write the power of studies. The power of studies. Amen. Hallelujah. The power of studies. Knowledge is very important. And we study to acquire knowledge. Amen. The reason why you study is to acquire knowledge. The reason why you need knowledge is that knowledge enables you to know what to do. Amen. Amen. Knowledge enables you to know what to do or how to live or how to practice something. And without studying, you cannot have knowledge. Without studying, you cannot have knowledge. And without knowledge, you cannot do anything. In fact, everything we do anchors on knowledge. Everything you do in this world anchors on knowledge. Amen. Amen. Everything we do anchors on knowledge. Amen. Amen. So without knowledge, you cannot do anything. In our basic work in life, whatsoever you do depends on what you know. Whatsoever you do depends on what you know. No matter how small it may look like, it all depends on what you know. If you do not know how to do a makeup, for instance, you can't do a makeup as a lady. You don't know how. You don't know how. By the time you finish, you just painted your face. You didn't do a makeup. It's about knowledge. But you may take it as simple as it may look. You may take it like, oh, that's not knowledge. But that is knowledge. We pay people to do makeup for us. We pay people to shave our hair for us. We pay people to style our hair for us. Yeah, the cream is everywhere. You can just go and buy a cream and style your hair by yourself. But you didn't try it because you don't know how. So it's through knowledge that you have what we call the know-how. Or the know-hows of life. You can write it, that's very important. Sooner or later, you get to know what we call the know-hows of life. Amen. 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 You have what we call the know-hows of life. What you don't know how to do, you will not try to do it. You don't know how to drive, you wouldn't try to drive because you will bash your car. Amen. You do not know how to bath, you wouldn't try to bath. Is that not true? So you are even taught how to bath whilst you begin to grow. Your parents teach you where to bath, where to touch, where to do this. even as you grow, because they want to have knowledge concerning birthing. Is that not true? As simple as it looks like. So everything about life anchors on knowledge. And we cannot underplay or undermine the role of knowledge in our walk of life. We can't. Cannot undermine the role of knowledge. And that means that we can't also undermine the role of studies in our walk of life. It is through studies that you acquire knowledge. You have to study to acquire knowledge. All the money your parents could have used to build edifices, they spent it on us, on you, to acquire knowledge. They were paying a school to give you knowledge. They were paying men, teachers, to teach you so you can have knowledge in your school. And they were paying for that. That is how valuable knowledge is. So your parents will go to work, they'll go to their farms, they'll go to driving, they'll go to wherever they're going, their bank and all that. Work for money and use that money to pay somebody. So the person will enable you to have knowledge. That's how costly knowledge is. Is that not true? We pay for knowledge. We pay for knowledge. It means that there's a price to pay if you want to be knowledgeable in every area of life. Some of us are doing our masters. Some are doing our doctorates. Some are still doing our degrees. Some are still doing one or two. And in all of these things, we are paying. It's not for free. And even with that, there is no guarantee that after paying and receiving that knowledge, you come out and you just get a job. But you still try it. Amen. You pay for it. So knowledge is expensive. And we shouldn't take knowledge for granted. Having said that, the knowledge we are talking about now is the knowledge of the Word of God. Amen. The knowledge of the Word of God is expensive. The knowledge of the Word of God comes at a price. But it's not a price of giving money. It's a price of giving your time. You hear what I just said? As expensive as the knowledge of the Word of God is, it comes at a price. The price of giving your time. See, the problem with most of us Christians is that we are not able to acquire knowledge of the Word of God because we don't give our time to it. See, we don't give our time to it. It takes time to study. It takes you creating time to study. And there is power. The power of studies is knowledge. Is that not true? Yeah. And the price to pay to study is your time. Write it down. It's very important. Price to pay is your time. Sometimes you have to be sitting down 4 hours just to study. Sometimes you have to listen to messages hours just to acquire something. Sometimes you have to study the whole day during weekends. Amen. Sometimes you don't have anything to do and you are studying. It's a trading of your time. So when you are studying the Word of God, you are trading your time to receive knowledge. So if you cannot trade your time, you cannot receive knowledge. Amen. I prefer that everybody that is here should come here. Amen. Everyone, Sammy, everybody should come here. Very important. Amen. So you are trading your time. You are trading your time to acquire knowledge. You are trading your time to acquire knowledge. It's very important. You are trading your time to acquire knowledge. And I want you to write that time in capital letters. Very important. Trade your time in capital, in bold letters. Very important. Because one of the reasons why we are not able to really study is because we don't want to trade our time. We use our time to do a lot of things apart from studying the Word of God. Amen. And it's very important that we understand that there is power in the studies of the Word of God. And I'm going to be taking through some scriptures how important it is to study the Word of God, how important it is to have knowledge. Amen. Some of the things that I studied many years ago are still working for me. They are working in me. They are still working for me. You can be a minister of the gospel and be able to really preach, but it doesn't mean that you have knowledge. Yes, amen. It doesn't mean that you are acquainted with knowledge. You can be a student of the word, you can be a person who comes to church. It doesn't mean that you are following the teachings we are giving you. Amen. Amen. Who is following what I'm saying? So it's very important. It's very important. It's very important that we trade our time with or for the knowledge of the Lord Jesus. We trade our time for the knowledge of the Lord Jesus. We can trade our time for a lot of things and watch a lot of things. But it's important we trade our time for the knowledge of the Lord Jesus. Why is it important? Because the knowledge of the word of the Lord Jesus will enable you or will cause you to do something. Christianity is about doing. It's about knowing and it's about doing. About knowing what Christ has done for you. About knowing who is inside of you. It's about knowing the Holy Spirit. It's about knowing the wisdom of God. It's about knowing a lot of things, the life of God. And after you've known all of that, you practice it. Whatever you don't do in your Christian work cannot yield results for you. Amen. So Christianity is about doing something. You have to do something. Sometimes we go to church, but we don't know the word of God. Sometimes we don't know what the word of God says concerning us, what God has said in our lives, what we can get in Christianity, or what we have gotten in Christ to manifest it, and all that. We don't know. We only go to church, and we just sit down there in church, dancing, giving offerings, and going back home. So we just see the church as a place. Today is Sunday and most people are in church, a place to sometimes dance. And some people going to church, I'm going to dance. Some people going to church, I'm going to show off my dress and all that. But that is not the primary reason for going to church, or for being a Christian, or for these Sunday services we are holding every time. The primary reason is for us to get knowledge. What kind of knowledge? The knowledge of the word of God. So there is a knowledge that we acquire through scientific whatever when you go to school. The knowledge you do political science and you know about politics, social science, and you know about what is happening in the society and all that. Biologic, what do you call all of that? Medical science and all that. Then there is the knowledge of the Lord Jesus. The knowledge that is derived from the word of God. Amen. Who is following what I'm saying? How powerful, how knowledge is very important. Knowledge is very important. Knowledge is very important. Knowledge is very important. I say this every time, not because I just love to teach, but because I've come to realize that everything that will happen in your life as a Christian will depend on what you know. And everything that you will do as a Christian will depend on what you know. When you don't know about love, you can't walk in love. When you don't know about faith, you can't work your faith or practice your faith. If you don't know about the Holy Spirit, you can't walk with the Holy Ghost. When the Holy Spirit is speaking to you, you don't even know he's speaking to you. You see, what you don't know in the kingdom can't work in your life. You can write that down. It's very important. What you don't know in the kingdom cannot work in your life. God is not just working around, I say it every time, that God is not just working around solving people's problems and changing people's lives. If that were the case, then nobody will be poor and nobody will be sick. And everybody in the hospital God will just go to the hospital and say, oh, what are you still doing here? Everybody. No. But the Holy Spirit, who is the working person of God, works based on the knowledge you have as a Christian. Amen. The Holy Spirit, who is the working person of God. Write that one down. It's very important. The Holy Spirit, who is the working person of God, works based on the knowledge of the word of God that you have. Based on the workings, on the knowledge of the word of God that you have. I remember years ago, I was sitting under some car park somewhere. And I was meditating on Galatians chapter 4, verse 1. The heir, as long as he is a child, says it's not different from a servant. Says that even though he is Lord of all. And in those days, I was going through a lot of things. So I wanted to study on how to receive our inheritance in Christ and how to walk in prosperity and how to walk in success and all that. That's an area you have to study. You don't walk in prosperity because we made declaration over your life. Amen. Today, if you listen to our message on Joy Prime, I made a statement that all of us online right now, if tomorrow morning you receive $100,000 in your account, we may never see you again. Right. So that $100,000 will only come when we are of full age. Amen. You should be. There are certain testimonies and there are certain miracles you only receive when you are of full age. When you are of full age, you can't receive a contract of what $500,000 because you go to church. No. You can't. You can only receive such contracts when you are of full age. When the Holy Spirit has looked at you, observed you, and looking inside of you, knows that you are equipped with the word of God enough to know what to do with the $500,000. I don't know whether you got what I said. Else, if you don't know what to do with the $500,000, the Holy Spirit won't give it to you. You are not knowledgeable in the word of God to know that. So to some people, that $500,000 worth of contract will be a trap to ensnare them. They wouldn't be able to go to church again. They'll be buying cars and be at the club because now they have money. So such amount of money won't come. But he knows that when you're of full age, to be of full age means that you have studied enough to know what to do with $500,000. You've studied enough. You know what to do with it. You know how to handle it. You know how to promote the kingdom with it. So all these things we are sharing with you every time is for us to know what to do as Christians. Amen. Not watch what will happen in our lives, but know what to do. What we are watching to happen in your life is based on you, what you do. What am I watching to happen? I'm watching to do this. I'm watching to do that. I'm watching to do this. And I'm looking at what to do for that which I'm watching to happen. Sometimes Christians just say, we are just watching. Whenever God is ready, he will do what he wants to do. I've said it over and over. That is not Christianity. That is religion. Amen. Amen. Job chapter 22, verse 21. Reading downwards. It means that every day you must set some time to study the word of God. Not to study. When we were growing up, we discovered that most people were studying the word of God just to preach. And most people thought that you study the word to preach. So if you are not a man of God, or you are not a preacher, you are not an elder, or you are not a leader or something, then you don't have to study. People were just studying the word of God just to preach. But we study the word of God to live. The Christian lives out the word of God. You don't know how to cast out devils apart from studying. You never know the authority you have in Christ apart from studying. You never know the inheritance you have in Christ apart from studying. Amen. So those of us who say that we see demons and all that is because we've not studied about your authority enough. Someone said, oh, I tried to cast out the devil did not go. It's because you've not studied enough. It's like taking half paracetamol. Amen. A whole tablet and you break it into two. Will it work? So if it's not working, it's not the para that is not powerful. Is that not true? It means that you just broke half. Or you are supposed to take two, you took one tablet. Is that not true? So you study until what you study works for you. Write that one down. You study the word of God until what you study works for you. You study the word of God until all the forces of the word begins to work in your life. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. So someone should just read quickly because of our time. And Job chapter 22, reading from verse 21 to 29. Mm-hmm. Please, who is that talking? Sam. Okay. Okay, so read it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So now listen. Sam, are you there? You are reading like you are reading the newspaper. Amen. Thank you very much, Brother Sam. It says, acquaint now thyself with him and be at peace. Acquaint now thyself with him and be at peace. Then it says, thereby good shall come unto thee. Amen. Good shall come unto thee. Now, when it says acquaint now thyself, it means that you, the Christian, can be acquainted with God. The Christian can be God's acquaintance. That means that God knows you and you know God. We have this thing that I think I've been teaching in church throughout, that many people see God as very mysterious. They think that God is mysterious, and many Pentecostal churches and most of the old churches have always taught how mysterious God is. But I think I've explained it over and over that God has made us stewards of his mysteries in the New Testament. So the scripture calls us stewards of his mysteries. That means that his secrets are revealed to us through his word. How he functions, what he does, what is given to us, what we should do in him are all revealed in his word. And you see, it says, acquaint now thyself. It means God wants you to come to a place, or wants us to come to a place, where we are so acquainted with him, where we are so known by him, and when we so know him. So it says, acquaint now thyself. It says, when a person is acquainted, and this happens through our fellowship with the word of God. Amen. That means we are studying the word of God. The word of God talks to us about God. And the word of God talks to us about our relationship with God. From the Old Testament throughout into the New Testament, you realize all of that. But I don't want to go into all of that now. Amen. So God wants us to be acquainted with him. We ought to know him. He ought to know us. Apart from the fact that you are born again, you should know God through his word. Amen. God should know you through your practice of the word of God, through your studies of the word of God, where God knows your level of maturity now as a Christian, where you are, whether you are at the milk stage, whether you are at the meat stage, whether you are still crawling. He knows. So how does he measure that growth? Through the word of God you have. God is not just working around solving people's problems and changing people's lives. If that were the case, then nobody would be poor and nobody would be sick. And everybody in the hospital God would just go to the hospital and say, oh, what are you still doing here? Everybody. No. But the Holy Spirit, who is the working person of God, works based on the knowledge you have as a Christian. Amen. The Holy Spirit, who is the working person of God. Write that one down. It's very important. The Holy Spirit, who is the working person of God, works based on the knowledge of the word of God that you have. Based on the workings, on the knowledge of the word of God that you have. I remember years ago, I was sitting under some car park somewhere, and I was meditating on Galatians chapter 4, verse 1. The heir, as long as he is a child, says it's not different from a servant. Says that even though he is Lord of all, and in those days I was going through a lot of things, so I wanted to study on how to receive our inheritance in Christ and how to walk in prosperity and how to walk in success and all that. That's an area you have to study. You don't walk in prosperity because we made declaration over your life. Amen. Today, if you listen to our message on Joy Prime, I made a statement that all of us online right now, if tomorrow morning you receive $100,000 in your account, we may never see you again. Right. So that $100,000 will only come when we are of full age. Amen. You should be. There are certain testimonies and there are certain miracles you only receive when you are of full age. When you are of full age, you can't receive a contract of what, $500,000 because you go to church. No. You can't. You can only receive such contracts when you are of full age, when the Holy Spirit has looked at you, observed you, and looking inside of you knows that you are equipped with the word of God enough to know what to do with the $500,000. I don't know whether you got what I said. Else, if you don't know what to do with the $500,000, the Holy Spirit won't give it to you. You are not knowledgeable in the word of God to know that. So to some people, that $500,000 worth of contract will be a trap to ensnare them. They won't be able to go to church again. They'll be buying cars and be at the club because now they have money. So such amount of money won't come. But he knows that when you're of full age, to be of full age means that you have studied enough to know what to do with $500,000. You've studied enough. You know what to do with it. You know how to handle it. You know how to promote the kingdom with it. So all these things we are sharing with you every time is for us to know what to do as Christians. Amen. Not watch what will happen in our lives, but know what to do. What we are watching to happen in your life is based on you, what you do. What am I watching to happen? I'm watching to do this. I'm watching to do that. I'm watching to do this. And I'm looking at what to do for that which I'm watching to happen. Sometimes Christians just say, we are just watching. Whenever God is ready, he will do what he wants to do. I've said it over and over. That is not Christianity. That is religion. Amen. And there are people who have come of full age through the word of God. They are so grown up in the word of God that they know how to handle situations through God's word. Amen. So there are levels, and he wants us to be acquainted. He wants us to grow in him through our fellowship. So he's telling us this, acquaint now thyself with him. I think last week I said it here that he says that, come and let us reason together. Come and let us reason together. And that is why Paul said that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion, the fellowship, our fellowship with the Holy Spirit, who is the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is the person of God revealed in this time. Amen. The Holy Spirit is the person of God revealed in our spirits now. So it says, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with us. The communion of the Holy Spirit be with us, to remain with us, to stay with us. The communion of the Spirit staying with us. Why? It's because it's through the communion of the Spirit that we become acquainted with God. Right, that one is very important. It's through the communion of the Spirit. And how can you have a communion with the Holy Spirit outside of the Word of God? You can't. Did you write that one down? What did I say? It's through the communion of the Spirit that we become acquainted with God. Through the communion of the Spirit that we become acquainted. And these are things that many Christians say it in churches. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, benediction, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us. The fellowship of the Spirit be with us. But less than 20% of Christians are experiencing or engaging in that fellowship of the Holy Spirit. Because when you are in fellowship and communion with the Spirit, you can't be in communion with the Spirit outside of God's word. Is that true? You have a fellowship with the Spirit through his word. Amen. And sometimes people have problems with listening or hearing the voice of God, and I tell them every time that once you give yourself, last week I talked about meditation this morning, once you give yourself to meditation of the word of God, you keep yourself to study of the word of God, and the ministry of the Holy Ghost inside of you is at work. Once it's at work, you begin to hear the Holy Spirit. Because according to Jesus, it's the Holy Ghost who will teach you and will guide you into truth. So you can't miss the voice of the Spirit. You become so acquainted with the voice of the Spirit. You know, this is God speaking to me. This is not God speaking to me. Amen. And this, all of these things happens through our desperation to be acquainted with God. That is why he says, acquaint now thyself with God, with him. He says, and be at peace. He says, thereby good shall come unto you. Amen. Amen. Then verse 22, he says, receive, I pray thee. Or In the New Testament, you use the word, I beseech you, or I beg you. I pray thee. The Old Testament talks, I pray thee. It says, receive, I pray thee, the law from his mouth. That is the word of God. And lay up his words in your heart. So the first 21, it talks about acquaintance. And how when we acquaint ourselves with God, is that not powerful? Are you following what I'm teaching? When we acquaint ourselves with God, it says, number one, we will be at peace. There is no pressure on your life, no matter what you are going through. And then it says, and good shall come unto you. Then now it comes to verse 22 to show us how. Verse 20 says, receive. Say, receive. Say, I receive. Receive, I beg you, I beseech you, I'm pleading with you. Is that not powerful? And God is pleading with us to receive his word. Receive, I pray thee, the law from his mouth, and lay up his words in your heart. So when the word of God is in your heart, when you receive the word, like I'm preaching like this, I'm teaching like this, you are receiving the word of God. Now, throughout this week, we've been placing the video on meditation on the pages. Amen. Why? So that you can receive the word into your heart. It says, when you receive the word of God into your heart, is that not powerful? Receive. Lay up the word in your heart. Then it says, when you do that, verse 23, if thou return to the Almighty, thou shalt be built up. So number one, when through our receiving of the word of God, we get acquainted with God. So receiving the word gets you acquainted with God. I don't want you to miss that aspect. Amen. Receiving the word gets you acquainted with God. It grants you acquaintance. You become God's what? Acquaintance. I remember I heard the word acquaintances. What does that mean? People that you are used to. Is that not true? People that you relate with in an intimate manner. So this is my acquaintance. Now, it means that God can be your acquaintance. Amen. The Holy Spirit can be your acquaintance. Some of us, the Holy Spirit is our acquaintance. We move by the Spirit. And people are carnal, they are not moved by the Spirit. Well, we move by the Spirit. We do things by the Spirit. Sometimes we even dress by the Spirit. Wear this suit. Wear this shoe. Remove this one. Wear this one. By the Holy Ghost. One time I heard the great angel saying the same thing. It's true. Go here by the Spirit. Amen. Sometimes the Holy Spirit so much stirs your inside that you don't have a choice than to study. We have come to that stage. Sometimes it's so much that you don't have a choice than to pray. Sometimes you're not even praying, but you can't sleep. You feel so burdened in your spirit. That burden is by the Spirit. You are his acquaintance. So you come to that point where you are the Spirit's acquaintance. Through studies. Remember what I just said? And as you study and you receive... Oh, you didn't hear what I said. I shouted glory over there. Say, I'm God's acquaintance. I say, God is my acquaintance. So you make decisions based on what God is saying. Not what based on what your mother-in-law is saying. Your mother-in-law says, don't come to church. Come here. Your pastor says, come to church. Say, I'm going to my mother-in-law. You are making a wrong decision. Is that not true? It's true, sir. Your mother-in-law says that she needs money, or your father-in-law says he needs money, or your brother-in-law says he needs money, and you too. You have to sow a seed into the church. So my brother-in-law said that need money, and you take that money and leave the seed behind. You've not become God's acquaintance. You know what I'm saying? When you come of age, what you spend on God is more important to you, first of all, than what you spend on yourself. Somebody came to me and said, you see, Papa, nowadays I don't have money. That's why, you see, that is why this New Year's seed you are coming to raise, I can't give much. Is that not strange? So it's part. I want to move forward, but I want you to catch that one. If you are online, say, I'm catching something. I want to catch the fact that God can be your acquaintance. and you can be God's acquaintance. That means that somebody that you are used to, somebody that you have a relationship with in an intimate manner, somebody that you can explain the person, you can explain God to somebody. God, don't you see what we read last week? So have you considered my servant Job? Who was talking? That was God talking. Have you considered my servant Job? So among all the people that were in the east at that time, God looked out and saw that there is this young man called Job, that he was now telling the devil that, have you considered him? Is that not true? Seeing that he's an upright person, have you considered him? Is that not powerful? When God looks at you, a world changer, he says, have you considered so-and-so person? Because God has considered you. He has weighed you. He has looked at you. He has observed you. And he has seen that you have become one with him. You have become his acquaintance. And he is telling somebody else about you that, have you considered this person? When you reach that stage, you don't touch something for it to prosper. Amen. When you reach that stage, is it clear? When you reach that stage, is it clear? Although all those who are online, you can unmute yourself and tell us if it's clear, if your line is clear. We want to know. Amen. You reach that stage, you don't enter an interview room to get a job. When you are God's acquaintance. Amen. You don't pray for things to have them. God knows you need them and supplies them as you need them. I've said it over and I said, God is a real person. He's not a force somewhere. The Holy Spirit is a real person that you can relate with. Amen. And when you have a need, he knows you have this need. Amen. So when you are his acquaintance, there's a stage when you are like a baby who you are now always asking, God, ask, Father, give me this. You know, I've been going through things. Please give me this contract. Please give me this job. Please give me. Those, when you see yourself at the give me stage, it means you've not come up. You are like a 7-year-old child or a 3-year-old child who is dependent on the father. I've said it before that when you come of age like Pastor Obed, you don't go and stand before your father and say that, Daddy, I'm going out. I want to go out. Is that true? What's happening with our network? Amen. Shout glory.
Get access to all of Pastor Prince's messages on YouTube and the Pastor Prince audio library, either from your mobile device or laptop. On YouTube, search for World Changers Nation and go to videos to see all messages. You can also search from the playlist button and see the different categories and series of pastors' messages. For audio messages, go to the Pastor Prince audio library by typing www.spotify.com and search for Pastor Prince Audio Library. Click on podcast to get access to all pastors' messages and more. You are blessed. Get access to all of Pastor Prince's messages on YouTube and the Pastor Prince audio library, either from your mobile device or laptop. On YouTube, search for World Changers Nation and go to videos to see all messages. You can also search from the playlist button and see the different categories and series of pastors' messages. For audio messages, go to the Pastor Prince audio library by typing www.spotify.com and search for Pastor Prince Audio Library. Click on podcast to get access to all pastor's messages and more. You are blessed.